I'd like to call the Roseville City Council meeting to order for June 25th, 2013. May we all rise and pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mayor Pro Tem Robert Taylor will not be with us tonight, so can I have a motion to excuse?
So moved. Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. He is excused. Under presentation and proclamations, we have presentation of proclamation to Autumn Milenark from Neighborhood Watch in honor of her winning the National Night Out Flyer Contest. So could I please have Ms. Carolyn Check from the Neighborhood Watch come to the podium, and would the council please join me down there also?
The Roseville Neighborhood Watch Group will be hosting our fifth annual National Night Out Against Crime at Veterans Memorial Park on Tuesday, August 6th, from 4 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. Since this is our 30th anniversary of National Night Out, Joel Scholl, one of our organizers here, came up with the idea to have the kids create a flyer for us. So a contest was born with the help of school board member Ruth Green and the art teacher of Norton Elementary School, Ms. Ruth Coates. We had close to 30 second graders participate in the event. They even added our mission statement, "We look out for each other. We love all the entries, but we can only choose one winner." So it was a very tough choice. Here's our board right here. And we are pleased to announce that Autumn Milenark has won. Come on up, Autumn. And you won a $50 gift card from Target. So we are in the process, and we're going to get these printed, and pretty soon you'll be seeing your flyer all over town. Congratulations.
Anybody gets a chance to come look at this board, it's very well put together. Congratulations. Thank you.
What did you get? I thought you were.
Under routine matters, request approval of minutes of regular meeting held June 11, 2013.
So moved. Support.
Motion by Councilwoman Hagerty, supported by Councilwoman McCartney. Is there any discussion on the minutes? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request approval of disbursement list.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Shoemaker, supported by Councilman Swatowski, to approve the disbursement list. Are there any questions for the city manager on the disbursement list this evening? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Madam Clerk, do we have any correspondence this evening?
I have nothing, Mayor.
Thank you. Next item is hearing of the public. The hearing of the public are designated. Public comments on agenda items will only be heard at the first hearing. Please approach the podium, state your name and address for the record. You're welcome to direct questions, input information, and express opinions to council. Anyone using inappropriate language will be called out of order and will correct their language or leave the podium. Limit your remarks not to exceed 3 minutes. Does anybody wish to be heard on agenda items only this evening? Anybody wish to be heard on agenda items only? Okay, seeing none, we will move into new business. Request to adopt resolution to approve the interlocal agreement Macomb Area Communities for Regional Opportunities Macro. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council. As most of you are aware, back in 2011, the city joined into a group of other municipalities to form the Macro Organization. The purpose of the organization was to bring together municipalities for common ground and research, recommending joint and collaborative projects, also to raise and seek funds through grant opportunities and the like. Since the institution of the organization in 2011, the group has grown. The group is now looking to be separated from each of the governing bodies and become their own established organization. You have before you this evening a request to approve a resolution, which will be an interlocal agreement formalizing Macro and their separation and being able to stand as their own organization. It has been reviewed by Mr. Tomlinson, and I'm asking for your approval this evening. There'll be a subsequent resolution following this to make appointments of our local representatives to the group as well.
Are there any questions for Mr. Atkins regarding this item? Councilman Sotowski.
Is there any cost associated with this?
No, all the costs have been taken. Most of the work has been done by the legal department of Macomb County, so the organization stand on their own. We have a great ability to be able to gain, though, from the collaborative, and that's what we've seen so far. So we've kept the cost in check as a neutral piece for the city.
That's all I have.
Any other questions? What's the wishes of the council?
Mayor, I move that we adopt the resolution.
I'll support it.
Motion by Councilman Shoemaker, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. Any questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request adoption of resolution to designate voting representative and alternate to serve as a member of the Macomb Area Communities for Regional Opportunities Macro Board of Directors. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council, in line with the resolution that you just recently approved, you have a separate resolution in front of you this evening requesting the appointment of myself and Mr. Cady as the representatives to the Macro Group on behalf of the city of Roseville.
Are there any questions for Mr. Cady regarding, or Mr. Atkins regarding this? All in favor?
Aye.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I got a motion.
Let's have a motion.
I move to support it.
Okay.
I make a motion to adopt the resolution naming Mr. Scott Atkins as our representative and Cady as the alternate.
Got a motion by Councilman Swatowski to appoint Mr. Atkins and Mr. Cady as our members, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request adoption of resolution to approve revised sewer rate. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, I'd like to bring a little bit of good news to you in regards to some budget items. And we'll hopefully have some more news, positive news for you afterwards. But at the point that the council approved the proposed fiscal year budget to begin on July 1st, we had established the sewer rate. At that time, we were given a number. Those numbers have since been adjusted by Detroit Water and Sewer, and we actually have a decrease in the rate that was approved by council. So I'd like to ask council for consideration on an adoption of a budget resolution. It will show that the original amount, which was proposed to be a 5.6% increase, has actually been reduced to show a 3.6% increase from the previous year rate. So still yet an increase, but much smaller than originally anticipated, therefore requiring a budget adoption resolution.
Any questions? Councilman Sotowski.
Yeah, we've got this three-page budget adoption resolution. On page two, I think it's the fifth item down. It shows combined rate for sewer treatment to be revised from $3.75 to $3.64. Is that the same or related to this?
That is the exact same piece. That's the decrease.
Okay, so that's the 5.6% to 3.6%.
Correct.
Okay. That's all I have.
Okay, any other questions? Seeing none, can I have a motion to adopt the resolution?
Move to approve the resolution as presented.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman Hagerty to approve the resolution as presented, supported by Councilman Swatowski. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request adoption of resolution to approve fiscal 2012-2013 budget adjustments. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council. As I kind of indicated, we do and are starting to see some positive news on the budget. You have before you this evening some documents with financial information. As required by city charter, each year prior to the end of the fiscal year, we're required to amend our budget. You have before you a request this evening to approve an amendment to our 2012-13 budget. And in essence, and I do have representatives from the Controller's Office here this evening to answer specifics. I know that this was recently placed in front of you. However, the summary of the news is, from our originally adopted budget to where we ended up, we did see an increase in revenue this year, although on the meager side of $149,000, we were able to adjust our expenditures and decrease those by an equal amount, and therefore providing you a balanced budget and balanced budget amendment with zero utilization of fund balance, as was our goal. At this time, if you have specific questions, again, we have representation from the Controller's Office to answer the specifics. I will also tell you that the majority of the accounts did seem to go in the right direction, which is a downward trend, although we had a couple of areas that were still higher on the expenditure side. Some of those were tied to the length of the negotiating process that we weren't able to achieve some of the savings. But we are trending, I believe, in the right direction, and this, to me, is a good indication of the marching orders that we had been given, and the support from council and our departments, employees, and staff members to make the changes, albeit sometimes more difficult, in the right direction on behalf of our residents.
Are there any questions from Mr. Atkins? Councilman Switowski.
Hey, just help me out here. Go to the last page. So are you showing our revenues down $62,000?
Mrs. Nancy, would you like to come up and address the council?
That last page is for the Chapter 20 Drain Fund.
Okay.
So in total, we broke each fund. What we did was go through each fund, look at each revenue and each expenditure type item, and adjust them for where we're at, any changes that we anticipate at June 30th.
Okay, and so that last take me to General's Fund then.
So the general fund, really, the highlights of it would be on page 2. And I thought it was not page numbered. It was quite extensive. But we had originally budgeted $34,500,000 for total revenues for the city. And after we reviewed all the accounts, we're coming in a little bit better than the original budget. We'll be at $34,682,000, a net increase of about $150,000. Equally, we went through all the expenditures for the general fund. And the reason being, too, is firsthand, when we adopted the original budget, it was with a 15% modification on the wages. And because some of the contracts settled a little bit later, we weren't quite sure we were going to achieve that savings. So that's why we went through and adjusted each line item for the expenditures that we've incurred to date and then any estimated expenditures, such as accrued payroll at the end of the year, accounts payable at the end of the year. And so, as a result of that, the expenditures are going to be in line with the revenues. And so we had originally hoped to basically have no effect on the fund balance for fiscal 12-13, and we are very happy to say we think we're on the right track.
Well, I'm glad of that, glad of not touching the fund balance, because
yes,
it's small enough as it is. But just looking, so up $150,000 in revenue, I see $50,000 of it on property taxes.
Right.
So we collected more than we thought. We thought it was going to drop worse. So is that a good message that it's not dropping as much? Maybe we are going to level off next year?
Well, actually, the increase in the property taxes is for two reasons. One is every year we have the estimated amount of tax that we're not going to collect from the previous years. And so our collections of past taxes were higher this year. So that helped us. So the amount that we budget for every year is the current property tax. So in this year, not only did we practically receive a lot of our current property tax, we also picked up some property taxes that were delinquent in prior years. So that's one reason it's a little bit higher. Then in addition, we also have a payment in lieu of taxes from some of our agencies that was higher this year. But for property taxes, the collections and the amount that we assessed were pretty close.
Okay.
So hopefully we won't have the decrease next year, but we're still budgeting as if.
So that explains $50,000 of the increase. Where is the other $100,000?
Well, it's a net. There's several in almost every account gets adjusted based on how things come in, but $50,000 of that, a large percentage of that was due to the property tax. A couple other highlights is if you look at your
your federal grants. We only originally budgeted $40,000 for federal grants, and then we budget $250,000 for state grants, and then another $280,000 for other grants, county-type grants. Well, this year, we are going to end up with pretty close to that same amount. We budgeted about $600,000 in grants. In total, we're going to have about almost $900,000 in grants. So that helped us pick up a few more dollars. Part of that was the SAFER grant, in addition to a drug court grant, and some of those other things. Then, in addition, we had state share revenue. We had budgeted $3.7 million. It looks like $4.2 million are coming in. So it's a series of those kinds of adjustments.
Okay.
Councilwoman Hagerty.
But the SAFER grant hasn't been finalized, is that correct?
This was the previous SAFER grant. This was the previous one. So we have applied for newer SAFER grants, but this was the one that basically we were awarded a couple of years ago. The revenue for that is being collected this year.
That would take us through this budget year?
That's it.
Okay.
Yes, we're done with it at this point.
Okay.
So we could actually recognize all those revenues this year.
Okay.
With this budget adjustment, how much money do we have in our fund now?
We still should have $4 million in our fund balance.
That's on the notes?
Pretty darn close.
Okay.
Pretty darn close.
All right. Any other questions?
If I may, maybe just to add a little bit onto what Councilman Switalski had mentioned. It is a balancing act between all of the functions of the city. As you go through this, and I'm sure you all will run home later tonight and look at it in more detail, but you will see, for instance, general city services, general operations of the city, most of those funds were all down and had a decrease. So where we did see an increase in a certain fund, we generally offset that with decreases in other funds. And the two largest ones that you're going to see under our general operations for general fund are public safety related. And as you all know, we were able to settle the contracts for both police command and police patrol. That did take a lengthy part and the majority of our previous fiscal year to get through. So we weren't able to realize all of those savings in the last fiscal year. We're now looking towards next year to start those. And you know, we're still in the process with the fire department. So when you look at some of those, we didn't achieve the savings. We're hoping that next year we're going to have an offset on those. But the majority of the other functions where we were able to achieve the savings, we have been able to do that. And I think that you'll be pleased to see most of that starting to fall in line. So we continue to work on the other processes. And again, on the side of the police department, those changes are now, those contracts are ratified, put in place, and those will be go forward beginning July 1st.
Any other questions? Thank you, Ms. Dancy. Can I have a motion to approve the resolution, please?
I'll move to adopt the resolution to approve the budget adjustments for 2012-13.
I'll support that.
Motion by Councilman Switalski to adopt the resolution, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. Any further questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request approval of Humana Healthcare and prescription coverage change. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of Council. As discussed previously in the budget preparation process as well as some special workshop meetings, we have placed before you this evening a copy of the letter in regards to the proposed Humana changes for healthcare and primarily prescription drug card, including the recommended hardship guidelines framed upon the federal poverty guidelines plus of 30%. Requesting Council's consideration and the approval of the changes as discussed through the budgeting and special workshop process.
Are there any questions regarding this matter? Seeing none, what are the wishes of the Council then?
Mr. Mayor, I'll make a motion to approve the Humana Healthcare and prescription coverage change.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Switalski, supported by Councilman Ayuda. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request approval to purchase two digital copiers. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of Council, as discussed at your most recent workshop meeting, we have put together a proposal for the purchase of two Konica Minolta copiers for City Hall, City Operations. There was a question that arose, was asked by, I believe, Councilman Ayudo in regards to a local vendor. I did make contact with the local vendor last week. They are not an authorized dealer or technician for Konica Minolta. They provide Kia Cera copiers, and I also followed up further. We have Kia Cera copiers also in use within the city, I believe primarily at the police department, so we do utilize their services. However, the specifications of the government bid were Konica Minolta, and those were to replace the two existing Konica Minolta BizHub copiers, so they would have like type of copiers. So you do have the information before you this evening for your consideration on the purchase and replacement of the copy machines, as are Konica Minolta to Konica Minolta on the government purchase price.
Councilwoman Hager.
Mr. Atkins, what will happen with the old copiers?
Because they're 6 going on 7 years old, and this was the reason for getting rid of those copiers, their costs are a little bit more than the newer copiers for us, so there's no value in maintaining them here. Again, maintenance costs increase, so we are going to first put those out to bid. We'll either use the Mitten program, which is the Michigan Intergovernmental Trade website, which we use commonly for items. If we have no purchases there, then it will come back to council, and we have an option to then donate those out to perhaps a local organization, but we will try to sell those first, and again, primarily using that inner trade network that we often use to sell our items from the city.
So if we do sell them, then that will offset the expense of the new copiers?
Any money that may have been gained, and I will warn you that we've been told from the copy company they don't take these on a trade-in because they really have no value at the end, at least for a trade. If anything is gained from this, from an outward sale, then that will go back into general fund, and it's all one fund where it's coming from. So going out from general fund, coming back into general fund.
And I don't suppose if we donate them to a charity that we can get any credit?
A nice thank you letter perhaps, but we can't benefit from any tax write-offs. So.
Okay, thank you.
Councilman Anderle.
Thank you, Mayor. Mr. Atkins, the new quote, when we, and I understand that this is a governmental contract holder, an AEPA contract holder, the Kyoceras, and the reason I'm asking the question is because it is a Roseville business that sells the Kyoceras. When we decided that we wanted to replace the copiers, did we look at features, or did we just say it was a Konica Minolta and there is a single source person in Auburn Hills, so we want to keep the Konica Minolta? Or did we look at functionality amongst various brands?
All of the above, and I'll answer that for you. Actually, prior to the purchase of the current BizHub machines, the Konica Minolta machines, about 6 years ago, there were a number of other machines that were entertained at the time. Xerox, Kyocera.
How many years ago?
6 years ago.
Okay.
They did look at options, and those were all put out for an extensive review period. At this juncture in time looking, it was to replace the same type of machines because everyone here operationally had been used to the Kyocera. We did also look, though, at other functional components because technology, as you know, changes and changes quite often. We looked at the integration of scanning services, which we use, and also eliminating our existing fax machines and incorporating those into the copy machine rather than having to buy extra. Now, also, I will tell you that Kyocera has that type of machine, Xerox, any of the Toshiba. Pretty much they all have these business network machines. But at this point, they looked at replacing piece for piece from Konica Minolta to Konica Minolta. So there was not a test or trial period. It was just looking at a replacement of the two specific machines with identical machines, obviously with the integration of fax. It was done through the government bid process because the bid work had already been put out, and the only authorized Konica Minolta dealer handling the bid is actually Konica Minolta US, who's located in, their offices are located in Auburn Hills. Certainly, if the council decides otherwise, we could go through a detailed bid process, bring in other machines, but again, I believe, and Mr. Katie could probably answer some more questions, he worked with purchasing direct on this, the thought was to try to keep the same type of machine. They had very good reliability, low maintenance problems, so to speak, although now they're getting older, they're prone to more. But again, keeping the same type of copy machine, which we would anticipate we would do the same moving forward in other departments. If they've been used to using a certain type of machine and they have a new replacement machine, generally the learning curve is quite different on that. But again, it could be done any which way. Just in this case, they stayed with the recommendation of the previous machines that were being used in purchasing and the general city office.
Where I'm struggling with this is that it's a Konica Minolta from a government, single source from a government contracted company in Auburn Hills, but we have a Roseville resident that owns a Roseville business that is an AEPA contract holder for Kyocera's. And I guess I would like to give that company that pays taxes in Roseville an opportunity to bid on this, function for function. If they can't match the price, they lose. But I think it's a functionality bid as opposed to a make and model bid. And that's where I've been struggling with this since this was brought in front of us last week. So my opinion is I think we should give a Roseville business the opportunity to bid on this. And my thoughts is that we table this. Thank you, Mayor.
If I may, Mayor, I agree with you. I understand you and I have had a chance to speak on this. And if the council chooses to go otherwise, my recommendation is that if we do move forward and go through a bidding process, that we also open the door. Certainly, we want to be able to give an opportunity to our local tax-paying businesses. But in all fairness, if they did this 6 years ago and they looked at a multitude of different types of machines, then perhaps that's the route. It takes a little more time, and that's okay. The machines that we have today are functioning, not at the best capacity, but they are functioning. So.
Okay, I just want to make the right decision, not the quick decision. Thank you.
Councilman Shoemaker.
Yeah, Scott, you answered half my question. The other half about going out to other, you know, opening bids to other companies, but what would the cost of that be?
Well, there's a publication cost for us because generally we'll advertise for the bids. You know, we can do that in a couple of different ways. Primarily, we do advertise in print media, either through the Macomb Daily or, as we usually do when possible, C&G newspaper. We also have an opportunity to be able to post this through Mitten, again, which is an online service that we participate in with other municipalities to be able to get the best outreach. But there is some cost because you will pay for an advertisement, whether it be electronically or in print. And I think that we would want to do both cases. We want to do the Mitten network, and we'd also want to make sure that we do it in the local print media.
Could we exclude the print media if we wanted to, though?
You could, but I'm afraid if you exclude the print media, you may exclude some of the local, perhaps in-city vendors who don't subscribe to the Mitten network. And I don't believe that that's the intention that we'd want, is to cut those out. I think we'd want to have the most opportunities on the table.
Okay, I just want it all laid out before we make a decision. Thanks.
Councilman Swatowski.
I was going to support the motion to table. I think, you know, we should give a chance to for the local business to see if the Kyocera is the equivalent of this one. Maybe it's worth bidding it out. If it's not, this is probably the best price we can get for the Konica Minolta. But I'd like to at least take a look and see if the other competitor is equivalent to it, and then, you know, give a chance to the local business.
Okay. Councilwoman Hager.
Did I not hear what the approximate cost of bidding this out is going to cost us?
I don't have the exact figures, but I would tell you that it's going to be several hundred dollars. I mean, the print advertisement is generally a couple hundred dollars, I believe. I'm looking at Mr. Cady for a nod. If we're doing two publications, you can increase that. And our price to advertise it on Mitten, we belong to that network, so that's not so much of a cost. So you're probably talking $200 to $400 if you do both of the local print, potentially $200 to $400.
Okay, thank you.
The only item that I kind of go along with Councilman Swatowski and Councilman Ayuto, you know, you have maintenance contracts, you have it's broken down into pennies for costs of maintenance contracts. I don't know if we have a flat rate maintenance contract, or if this other company that they're talking about, Kyocera, has a flat rate versus a per page maintenance. So I'd like to table it also, just to make sure we have all our ducks in a row.
Mayor, if I can, usually, I mean, any company will offer a flat rate piece, but most copy companies, and I'm sure that the Kyocera plan would be the same, they meld it kind of in and mesh it in with the proposal, so you're doing it at a per copy page price. And they're all pretty common, so I'm sure that we'll see all of the proposals come in. But we can also put options or alternatives that we can have it as a flat rate maintenance cost as well.
Okay. Let me go back to Councilman Iota. Was that a motion?
Having said that, Mayor, I'll make the motion to table this agenda item.
Support.
And I got a support by Councilman Swatowski. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. The item is tabled. Next item is appointments. I have none. The next item is reports of city manager. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor. Thank you. As I reorganize my paperwork and do the paper shuffle here, bear with me. I have a few items for you this evening. One, I've provided you with your weekly update that you should have in front of you. I'd be glad to answer any questions that you have on those items. Walk Michigan begins on June 27th at 6 p.m. at Veterans Memorial Park. For information, contact the Rec Authority, 445-5480. City offices will be closed on Thursday, July 4th for the Independence Day holiday. City Hall will also be closed to the public on July 5th. Trash collection will be one day behind on Thursday and Friday of that week. And utility bills, there are a portion of utility bills that have a due date of July 5th. The due date will be extended until July 8th, so no one will be penalized for a due date on July 5th. That'll be extended to the 8th, but the drop boxes are 24/7, 365 if somebody wants to pay early. Summer tax bills will be mailed by the treasurer on Monday, July 1st. If you have any questions about the tax bills, contact the treasurer at 445-5420. The library has several items, and they're always items of interest. On Wednesday, June 26th, which is tomorrow at 7 p.m. in the Aaron Auditorium, the Ghost Hunters of Southern Michigan will be coming to the library to kick off their summer reading club for adults, and I'm told that it will be a scream. I'm just reading what's put down. Thursday, the 27th at 2 p.m., taking a line for a walk. Start with a simple line. You won't believe where it takes you. Local artist Cynthia Rent will be a guide through this children's art project using various expressive lines, and they are asking for registration prior to that event by contacting the library. And then on Tuesday, July 9th at 6 p.m. in the auditorium, Aaron Auditorium, will be the Exotic Zoo, and they'll bring rare and exotic animals to the library, concentrating on animals that you dig. Not digging animals, I guess. Armadillos, prairie dogs, alligators may be part of the animal collection, so all ages are welcome to attend this fun and educational program. And I don't know, alligators in the library, that'll be a little different. Again, any questions on the programs? They always have great programs. 445-5407. Construction updates. We're still working on our local construction projects, which are open cut sanitary sewer repairs, some inline repairs, and also pavement patching and joint seal work. Those will continue through the month of June, especially the joint seal program, which will be on Hayes and Gratiot and Fraso and 11 Mile. Grosbeck and I-94 also have continuing lane closures and restrictions. The signage has been very good on I-94. They have tended to give us pretty much a heads up on the electronic signboards because those lane restrictions do change. Most of them are evening and weekend restrictions, taking away one or two lanes. And then the Grosbeck work is a continuation of the lane restrictions out on Grosbeck. And I believe that their area right now is near Utica. So those are the items that I have for you as updates this evening.
Are there any questions for Mr. Atkins this evening? Mr. Atkins, I have one question this evening. I did receive, like all our residents, a bulletin from Rizzo Services that are going to start our new waste program. It says that they will go into effect on July 1st. So is that an affirmative?
We have yet to receive back the contract signed. However, all indications are waste management will finish on June 30th. Rizzo will begin on July 1st. We've agreed. We just are waiting for the executed copy to come back. Also, Rizzo is accepting the phone calls, as my understanding, for the recycling carts. And I have a little item to squeeze in, if you allow me. We had discussion at our last special meeting about residents wanting to provide the rubbish carts, the 96-gallon carts. We are going to be ordering, I believe we'll start with three truckloads of those carts. That'll give us probably about 1,500 or so carts. And we'll begin the process of notifying residents of how to obtain those carts. It will take us probably a significant matter of weeks before we will have delivery on those. But we will have those available and we'll provide the information on the cost here at City Hall for residents that want to purchase a 96-gallon cart. But the recycling carts, please contact Rizzo at the number provided in the mailing for your recycling cart.
Okay, I was going to, it's 1-866-772-8900. For the residents if they want the recyclable cart. Any other questions for Mr. Atkins?
And then it's
Councilman Abel.
And just to be clear to everybody, the recycling cart is free if you call, and the rubbish cart is, there's a fee. Did you say what the fee is? We're still working that out.
Yeah, we don't have a verification of the fee. We expect to be somewhere in the $50 range or so. And that cart, again, the rubbish cart is purchased by the resident. They have ownership of that cart. The recycling cart is provided as part of our contract. That is something that is technically a city cart. So if it's damaged beyond repair, you know, we can have verification. We'll work with the residents. If it's stolen, the police report. But if somebody just takes it and moves to another community, it is city property. And if somebody wants two carts, they'd have to buy their second one. So we provide the one upon request for recycling. We'll have more information and try to keep everybody updated. I know it's always difficult when a change occurs.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Seeing none, we'll move into reports of city attorney, Mr. Dolan.
Mayor and council, I don't have any specific items to report on this evening.
Are there any questions for Mr. Dolan this evening? Seeing none, we will move into the second hearing of the public. It will be for any city business. Upon approaching the podium, please state your name and address. Address the chair. You're welcome to direct questions, input information, and or express opinions to council. Anyone using inappropriate language will be called out of order, correct their language, or leave the podium. Please limit your remarks to not exceed 3 minutes. Anybody from the public wish to be heard by the council this evening?
Good evening.
Come on up, sir.
I'm going to start quick because 3 minutes. My name is Nathan Flanagan. I live at 18727 Melvin. I'm accompanied by my wife and four of my neighbors. We're here regarding a 28350 Johns, which is considered either a halfway house or a tether house, if you will. It's been there about a year, and it seemed relatively fine in the beginning. They were older gentlemen and kept to themselves. Over the last 10 days, a couple of younger gentlemen basically turned our street corner into a panhandling corner. So begging for change, cigarettes, what have you, at the corner. To the point where, you know, we used to have people actually walk their dogs and their kids and all that, pretty much ceased to exist now because it's like a gauntlet going down the side of the street. Call the police and they have come out. Hasn't really stopped the situation, as it were. Basic question is, was it ever approved to be a halfway house or a tether house? That's our biggest concern. I mean, I travel extensively for a living over 100 days a year. I have my wife by herself, three kids in this home. Her husband as well travels a lot, and it's just the randomness of the people coming through this home. Granted, some of them are probably looking to start over, but I'm just curious of how this stuff works and how it got approved, if it is approved or not. So, and we're just a little bit nervous about it.
Mr. Dolan?
Mayor and council, generally speaking, these special types of uses, which would include group daycare facilities and facilities that are handling persons who are under the jurisdiction of the penal system, that's regulated by state law. The state, through legislation, has taken away our ability to zone in this area with regard to a specific land use. And so long as they're at a certain occupancy level, they would be within their rights typically. A larger home might not be appropriate in most neighborhoods, but as long as they're within a certain occupancy limit, they're probably okay. However, all of our penal ordinances apply. Our loitering ordinances, our littering ordinances, our public disturbance ordinances. So we can still try to monitor the situation as best we can, but insofar as their ability to be there in the first place, that's largely regulated under state law. And also I should add is that there are some counterpart federal statutes that would apply as well with regard to certain types of daycare uses where they have federal protection as well.
So we'll probably have to go to the state then, or?
No, sir.
These are state-run facilities, and you can direct your criticisms to the state agency that controls those facilities. The city manager's office and myself would be glad to provide you some additional assistance if you want to contact us later.
That'd be great.
Sir, first of all, let me just say this. Number one, our city manager took your address down.
Okay.
He will check with the building department to see if it's a rental, non-rental, or if it's somebody that purchased a home. Our police chief is sitting right there. He will go back and tell the shift commanders and monitor that, because I sure don't want people walking around Roseville. What do they do? They just...
Well, I think he's testing, they're testing the boundaries of their tether.
Mm-hmm.
And I see him trying to see how far they can go up and down, and basically up and down the sidewalk, all the way around the corner, going across the street. That's, you know, because I'm monitoring, I mean, I travel, so I'm home right now, so I'm watching everything from across the street.
Well,
and then anybody that walks by, they're always being stopped and asked for something.
Well, the chief can check on who's the occupants in there. If they're state parolees that are tethered, then that is a matter for the state police, that, or for the state to and their parole agents. Mr. Atkins, you give us a report on it so we can help this gentleman out?
Yep, absolutely.
Great. Thank you very much.
Councilwoman McCartney, you have a question?
Yeah, just a quick question. These are registered with the police department, correct, Chief?
Only if they're sex
offenders.
Only if they're sex offenders.
Thank you.
Unfortunately, the state of Michigan for halfway houses say you can have six occupants in a house, and it is governed by their laws, their criteria. It's not ours, but we can make sure that your neighborhood's safe, though. That's what we can do.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard this evening? Don't be bashful. Come on up.
We're all together.
Okay.
All
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
He said it all.
All right. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard? Seeing none, we will go into items for discussion. But before we go into items for discussion, we do have a closed-door session today. But Mr. Atkins tells me that there's nothing forward to produce with the firefighters' negotiations. So can I have a motion to remove that off the agenda, please?
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. So the closed door session is removed. The next item is items for discussion by City Council. Councilman
Mayor, I'm glad you had that mail out from Rizzo, because I got that same thing and I took it and I called up because I wanted to get my free recycling bin, my red wheeled container. And picked up my call immediately. It was about a 15-second conversation. They wanted to know my address and what day my trash was picked up. They said they'd deliver the wheelie container in about a week, so that's great. And when the rubbish ones come out, I have three good metal cans, but I'm going to go for a rubbish one too. I'm going to throw down $50 for that one. So I think those will be really well received, and I think $1,500 is, those will go. I'm feeling those are going to go fast, so that's good. Had a ball at the fireworks. I had a great time at the fireworks. I thought we were going to get rained out. I thought the thunder was out there. It was looking bad, and it turned out to be beautiful. It was a nice, cool breeze. I saw a friend of mine, Teresa Vitale, who had a booth there. For $25, you can get a booth and sell stuff, and there were a bunch of vendors there. And she was selling these little candy Krispy Kreme things. So I sat there with her and watched the fireworks. And the businesses, there's a party store on the corner of, I think it's like Barkman and 11 Mile. There were people lined up all the way to 11 Mile or toward the park all night. I talked to the cop working the corner. He said, you know, they've been here all night like that. As soon as one person comes out of the store, one gets to go in. So they were doing a bang up business there. And the pizza place, two doors down, they set up outside $5 for a whole pizza. I mean, they were just, you know, couldn't sell them fast enough. So they were doing great. So it was nice to see all the people out there having fun, the movie. Saw a lot of people I knew, and, you know, it was a great success, really well done. And that morning, before the fireworks, I went to the Mayor's Millennial Conference. I'm the city's representative there. And it was at Hazel Park Raceway, and I screwed up, and I don't know what happened. I got named to the executive board. I don't know how this happened, but I'm on the executive board now. And their project for this coming year is to try to get what they call millennials, that are people between the age of 18 and 35, to get them involved in government. And their project is, you know, can they get some millennials appointed to boards and commissions within the cities? So they have some best practices recommendations. I'm going to sit down with the administration to kind of go through. I think we're doing a bunch of them already, but there's a few that they suggest, like putting things on Facebook and not opening. And, you know, we'll hopefully get a few young people involved. That's all I have.
Thank you. Councilman Angelo.
Thank you, Mayor. I wanted to also talk about the fireworks. I talked to Phil Longelf, who was chairman of the committee, on Sunday, the day after the fireworks, just to discuss. I drove around the perimeter of Veterans Memorial Park, about five blocks every which way, and everybody was having picnics, everybody was blocking off their streets. And I said, I wish there was a way to really define how many people get to enjoy that one night in the city of Roseville, and how much revenue is generated to local businesses, the people that are selling the hot dogs, the bratwursts, and the potato chips, and the pop, and the adult beverages, all of those things that one night generates goodwill, great thoughts of the city of Roseville. So congratulations to the fireworks committee. The display was fantastic. And I just wanted to say thank you to the fireworks committee and thank you to everybody that was involved. And I'm going to leave it at that. Take care of each other.
Thank you. Councilman Shoemaker.
I too was able to attend the fireworks, and I thought the event was great. And just want to wish everybody a happy and safe 4th of July weekend. That's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you, Councilman. Councilwoman Haggerty.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to congratulate Autumn on her award for the National Night Out. I think she did a great job, and I'm proud of her. And congratulations to the Fireworks Committee. They put on an awesome show. It was a good time for everyone. The rain held off. Fireworks were great. Everyone had a good time. I would like to ask the citizens to please adhere to the rules of the fireworks. We have tried to get the message out that you cannot shoot off fireworks, and people are disturbed, and I understand it, and I'm frustrated as well. But you cannot shoot fireworks off except for the day before, the day of, and the day after a national holiday. No time in between. And if someone is doing it, either call the police or take a video and show it to the police. That's the only recourse we have at this point. So I'm hoping that we can resolve this in a reasonable fashion. And I'd like to wish everyone a happy 4th of July, and please be safe. Thank you.
Councilman McCartney.
Thank you, Mayor. I too want to say what a great time I had at the fireworks. Firework committee did an outstanding job. All the departments, the rec, the police. I love that I was able to get out of there at not too bad of a time. So thank you for all that. DPW, the gazebo looked beautiful. So whoever painted that gazebo, I know it was a DPW. It looks gorgeous. You guys did a great job. I'd like to get a get well wish to Dave Diebold. He's a teacher over at the high school. So get well wishes to you. And for the residents, thank you for looking out for one another. I know it was tough for you guys to come in here and say what you said, but thank you. It's very important. It did the other neighbors, I'm sure, some good if they were watching. So thank you for bringing your concerns here. And happy 4th of July to everybody. And that's all I have.
Well, I have a bunch of thank yous tonight. You've heard all the council people up here talk about how great our fireworks were. We had a successful fireworks show. It was sanctioned. It was great. It was about 27 minutes long. It was a heck of a time. It is a smashing good time, I should say. But anyways, I would like to thank and acknowledge some of the people that helped put this on. First of all, you have the Recreation Authority. You have Councilman Ayuto and Councilman Swatowski sit on the board, and Charles Frontera. A special thanks to Tony Lipinski and Bobby Wilson, the director and assistant director. They coordinated with the police department, fire department, and DPW, and they did a great job, and I just want to thank them for that. I'd like to thank all the city volunteers that took their time out to work for us. I can't name you all, but you know who you are, and I'd just like to say thank you very much from the bottom of my heart for all the hard work you did. The police department, fire department, DPW workers, you know, I always say how good our workers are, and they did a fine job taking care of it. I would like to give a special thanks to Christian Financial Credit Union, because they were the one that gave us the most money to put on these fireworks like they did last year, and hopefully they'll do it in the years to come. But I'd like to thank them. I'd like to thank National Coney Island, Vans Towing, RCO Engineering, Great Lakes Recycle, and Metro Beverages. They were just some of the people that gave big checks to sponsor it so our citizens could have this fine day and it wouldn't be paid with taxpayers' money. I'd like to thank the committee, Bob Taylor, my mayor pro tem, Peggy Schimantero, Kevin Swetnowski, who also sits on the school board, Ron Blazewski, Scott Baylor, one of our firefighters, and Bob Fronrath from Vans Towing. They did a great job. Like Colleen said, the DPW did a fine job sprucing the park up. It is one of our jewels in the city, and it was looking good that night. It was really good. And just for a plug, you know, next year's collections are starting, so if anybody wants to donate money, they can send it in care of the city manager's office of the Roseville Fireworks Committee. With that, that's all I have, except everybody have a very, very good and safe 4th of July holiday. With that, a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilwoman Haggerty. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We are adjourned.